Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So, good afternoon. I'm Phil Fawcett. I help do technology transfer inside of Microsoft Research worldwide, but I invited Barbara and her team here from the University of Washington Center for Information Assurance and Cybersecurity, which she started several years ago. And it's an interesting area that I think anytime you deal with information, you know, how do you make sure it's credible? How do you make sure it's protected? All sorts of interesting things. I have a lot of empathy and with Barbara because we're both like late age or late career stage PhD students. So I'm also a PhD student at the University of Washington as well in information science. And so it's great to have her and her team here. I hope that everyone that sees this video will contact Barbara and her team, figure out a way to contribute because I think it's a number of really hot issues and really an exciting area to be part of. And so with that, I'm gonna have Barbara start off. She's brought a team of students here, which I think will provide just an awesome overview of the work they're doing, as well as the field itself and where some of the really hard problems are. So thank you very much for listening. And with that, I'll have Barbara come up and take it away. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Phil. I feel your pain. I'm so happy to be on the other side of it. Curiosity kills the cat. I don't think I'll ever be curious about anything as again, Phil. I want to welcome people here this afternoon. We're going to talk about the Center for Information Assurance and Cybersecurity. And as Phil mentioned, we're interested in engaging Microsoft in a dialogue about how we at the University of Washington might partner with Microsoft on a number of initiatives that we are currently undertaking. I'm hoping that this sparks some thinking on your parts in terms of ways we might collaborate. Maybe there are other projects that you think are tangential that will occur to you as you see this presentation unfold. We are a center of academic excellence designated by the Department of Homeland Security and the NSA. This is a little bit about me. I am the director for the center, but I'm also a research associate professor in the Information School. My research areas span a number of interests. I'm interested in deception as it gets deployed in digital forensic tools. I'm also interested in forensic-ready networks, and I'm doing some work with the UBC in library and archival science, looking at how we might learn from librarians about what to store it, how to authenticate digital records. I'm also interested in compliance of all kinds because it's certainly a huge problem overwhelming organizations. And then I'm looking at how do we define the emerging sciences of information assurance and digital forensics. They're not really well defined. We don't know how to talk to one another in the field. So there's some very interesting work being done at the very beginnings of the evolution of these fields as sciences. They're certainly well developed in some ways as practices, but what about the science that's repeatable? I have been the author of book chapters and publications. I'm in the academic world, so it's publish or perish. And I do currently have a number of PhD students and master's students. You'll meet a few of them this afternoon. We're going to go over a little bit of background and history on the center to kind of ground you in the context for what the University of Washington is doing. Also want to give you a sense of the collaborations and partnerships that we've engaged, as well as an overview of our current work. And towards that end, there are two projects that I've selected to talk about specifically. One is the Information Assurance Body of Knowledge, and it maps to a secure coding project that we're doing. So we'll go into that in a little bit of depth, and also what we're doing with Next Generation Honeypots, or in other words, how do we stay ahead of the bad guys? I mentioned that we are an NSA DHS designated Center of Academic Excellence, but it's in education and research. There have been a number of universities with an education designation, but only a couple of handfuls of universities that have that designation in the research area. And, of course, the University of Washington is a Tier 1 research institution, and we are able to apply our research might to this cybersecurity problem. The NSA-DHS program stresses domain partnership. Now, there's a lot of lip service given to academics and industry and government working together, easier said than done in many ways, because those domains are so radically different, different cultures, different expectations, different goals, different motivations. But I like to think that we do this very well, and I think you'll see that we have worked with Microsoft in various parts of the organization, worked with a very large airplane development company in the Pacific Northwest, worked with a number of areas of government. The whole program that the NSA and the Department of Homeland Security began to promote back in 1996 is emphasizing domain partnership and how do we grow IA professionals. I'd like to acknowledge that Microsoft was involved in the early days of establishing this movement. In fact, we had a major colloquium back in the last decade, here at the Microsoft campus, where all of the centers of excellence at that time congregated. There have been various people who have been the point of contact within Microsoft for this movement. Arkady Retik is one, who's here this afternoon. And David Ladd, whom some of you may know, had occupied that position. So Microsoft has been an industry that's been pivotal, perhaps behind the scenes for many of you, in spurring on this movement that's designed to help create IA professionals. What was the motivation behind the government getting into designating these centers? Well, for one, I probably don't have to tell you folks that the threat spectrum has certainly escalated. The days of the 12-year-old drinking Jolt all night long causing mayhem are well behind us, and we're looking at very organized nation-state, organized crime attack vectors and a very serious threat that certainly has gotten a lot of people's attention. And secondly, it's the growing awareness that our critical infrastructure is interdependent. And this is a national security concern because critical infrastructure, the electric grid, the power, the water systems, the transportation system, the banking system, all of these things are so critical to our way of life. Just have the ATM in your local neighborhood go down and you know how inconvenienced you become. These systems are now linked to public networks, and I know that there's policy in place that says that doesn't happen, but I'm here to tell you, based on research that I've done personally with NIST, that it does indeed happen. There are workarounds everywhere, and so while it is not as easy as talking about intrusion from a public network, it does present a vulnerability that can happen. And further, these critical infrastructure assets are owned and operated primarily by private companies. This makes it very difficult for the federal government to really have much say in how they're defended against cyber attacks or to levy any kind of regulation that asks for mandatory improvement. So the influence has to come from getting people aboard in the universities who understand what the problems are and are prepared to go out in industry and solve those particular problems. And then in 1996, when this program was originated, we saw an emerging series of job categories that were being unfilled because we didn't know where we were going to find those professionals. The options were on-the-job training. You grew your security professionals. There have been emerging certifications, but nothing that's been standardized and accepted as a standard that we can universally agree is the appropriate one. And there has been at the time, or there had been, little happening at the academic level in universities to train faculty, to train students. And so the government launched a program to create these centers to meet the demand for experts and to help equip these experts to protect information infrastructure, provide recruits for federal government employment, and encourage IA research in critical areas. So that gives you a sense of where all this happened
and how Microsoft got involved a number of years ago and what prompted universities to begin teaching this subject area. And here's a list of some universities you might know. It's certainly not exhaustive. There's over 100 schools and universities, many of them a lot smaller than these, that do offer educational programs in information assurance that have been qualified by a peer review and an overview by the federal government. And of these institutions, as I mentioned, about a couple dozen of them are also designated as research centers. This is the way that picture mapped out on the globe in 2004 when the university decided to apply to become a center. So this program had been underway about 8 years before UW stepped up. We were too busy making money in the dot-com bubble to be concerned about all that security stuff. So we didn't really see a big interest emerging at the universities until about 2004. And you can see the opportunity that was perceived. Most of those centers of academic excellence, those red stars, were concentrated in the Beltway. And that kind of makes sense because it was the federal government that was hiring most of these people, and universities generally train people to work within a 30-mile radius. I don't know if you're aware of that, but that tends to be typical, that students will work and stay near where they graduate. So it was pretty obvious there was nothing going on in this area in the state of Washington. There were a couple of centers in Idaho, but the Pacific Northwest was wide open, so that spells opportunity. And that led to my going aboard the University of Washington to breathe life into this idea of a center of excellence. I was fresh with my PhD in cybersecurity, computer science, and so I was very enthusiastic about what we could do with the potential of a University of Washington. And this is a conceptual model for how our center operates and is managed. For those of you that come from academia, you're very well aware that there are three things academics are graded on. They're graded on their research. Can you get grant money? Do you perform research that's recognized? Do you teach? Do you teach these subject areas? Do you teach them well? And do you do outreach work to the community or within your university to disseminate information about your field or make contributions to your field? And we do all three areas. We have activities going on in all three, and I'll get into a little detail in just a moment. I'd like you to note that at the center of our conceptual model is the Agora. I don't know how many of you attend the Agora or have heard about it, but it's a unique institution that isn't really an institution. It's a meeting on a quarterly basis of security practitioners from all over the United States. They don't even have a formal charter, so they're an organization that's a non-organization. But they've been meeting to solve mutual security problems for over a dozen years. I think it's going on about 15 years now. And I'd like to invite anybody who is listening to this presentation or in our audience to the next meeting, which is taking place on the University of Washington campus in the Hub Auditorium, June 18th in the morning. It's a Friday. It's a half-day workshop. It's free, plus all the donuts and coffee free that you can consume, which generally attracts students. But it's nice to be able to go to a free conference, and there are usually three presentations on current interest matters done by practitioners as well as academics who might be doing research in this area. And so the next one, again, is coming up this June, and there'll be another one in September. But get aboard the Agora freight train. The Agora is a source for me of practitioner knowledge of what's happening on the firing line. The problem with this field is that us pointy-headed academics are often accused of being out of touch with reality. And it can happen very quickly because you step away from the front lines in this cybersecurity space and you quickly get behind in your knowledge. And so to stay on top of things, we reach into that community and make ample use of guest lecturers in our academic offerings, in our research activities if an opportunity arises. So we work very closely with practice. In any emerging field, there's always a huge gap between the academic defined science and the practitioner community, and it exists for a long time, and gradually they move towards convergence, although in something as dynamic as our field, I don't know if we'll ever arrive at the same space. So there's always going to be that tension. We preserve that tension in the classroom. Yes, there's a question.
Do you have a link where we get information about the Agora program?
Actually, they don't have a website. You can find out about it through me, and I'll put you on the mailing list. Very happy to do that. Endicott, E-N-D-I-C-O-T-T, like Endicott, Washington, no relation, which it wish there was, at uw.edu. Okay? So moving on to look at our academic offerings, this might be of interest to you. You'll see this pedagogical model a little while later in another presentation, but we offer classes, workshops, certificates, and concentrations in master's degrees in various departments on campus. So there's quite a wide range of offerings in information assurance and cybersecurity, and we have a growing number of professors who've taken an interest in this space. You'll see some names in a little bit. I'd like to point out in this particular slide that we are student-centered in our approach to designing curriculum. The goal is to take people on the front end and turn them into IA practitioners, going through a process that's unique every year. I revise curriculum every year because it is a fast-paced field. I make sure things are refreshed. The goal is to turn students into experts. This is a description, high level, of two certificates that the center has created and is offering, and a shameless plug. These certificate programs start in autumn. We will be recruiting our seventh cohort. There is a list of the three classes that consist of each certificate. The first, Information Systems Security, is a hands-on kind of course that gives you the basics of securing an environment from a technical hands-on perspective. You can look at the courses that are included, Foundations of Information Security, Tools and Technologies, and Applied Solutions and Emerging Trends. This course is offered downtown. We have labs down there. So that is our entry-level certificate or our first certificate offering. And then for people who want to step up to responsibilities for security, we have the Information Security and Risk Management Certificate, which recognizes you will never have a 100% secure system. You're always making trade-offs. So the courses include Information Security and Risk Management in context. So we're looking at various industries, various conditions of a company. Is there a lot of mobile workforce issues going on? So we look at the problem from a variety of perspectives the first quarter, and then we build an information risk management toolkit the second, and then I bring in a practitioner who has live cases from his practice, real cases, they change every year, and we bring them into the classroom and allow students to solve them. The goal being that when they walk out that door, they should feel empowered to be able to take on problems. That particular class is offered, a series of classes, is offered both online and in the Seattle classroom. You also can take it for credit and have those credits stored towards a master's degree if you're so inclined. End of shameless plug. In terms of outreach, here are some downloadables that might be of interest to you. We have a lecture series called The Unintended Consequences of the Information Age. You might recognize in the right hand there Ed Lazoska, who chaired the first lecture series that we put on privacy reconciling reality. Rob McKenna was a keynote for the second on privacy versus free speech. And then we had a wide-ranging series of lectures that captured what we're doing with our infrastructure. It's online and it's vulnerable. These are available for download. They're MP3 audio files as well as video files. Just follow that link and store them on your computer for later viewing. This is an interesting project that we've had that's been a wonderful outreach opportunity that we have shared with the Microsoft Corporation. We have put on the Pacific Rim Collegiate Cyber Defense Competition every year now. For the last 6 years, it became a full-fledged competition 3 years ago, and Microsoft graciously hosted it here on campus. We've now actually found a home at a university that's willing to give up their labs because we can get in there over spring break. But Microsoft remains an ardent supporter, and we are very grateful. If you'd like to see the documentary that describes this, the link is below that picture. And, oh, I hope you can see this. We want to say thank you to Kim Hargraves and to Kevin Sullivan, who've been real supporters and champions of this program. Thank you, more than I can say. It's a huge, big learning experience for students. They spend the weekend defending in teams similar networks that are seeded with flaws, and we bring in a red team from the outside that attacks them mercilessly, and their goal is to stay alive, keep services up and running, and execute those pesky administrative chores that bosses always make you do while you're up to your neck in alligators. We also have the Ice Creamy Conference that's now become an institution. We're in our fourth year, I think, coming up this September, where we look at compliance and risk management impacts from a variety of perspectives. It's here where we began to, several of us, work on the crossover between archiving and digital forensics. Now, in the research area, this is how we approach research. This is a conceptual model similar to the model I showed you for how we develop curriculum. This is how we think about doing research and disseminating research at the university. If you're familiar with how academics operate, they choose their own direction. And so unless you can align with their interests, often it's very difficult to get their attention. However, one thing that a center can do is offer dissemination for what's already existing. And so for those projects that are already underway in the security space, we do just exactly that through workshops and conferences. With external partners, we have a directed research capability where problems are brought to us and we have the ability to assemble the talent that will address those problems. This is really an exciting opportunity for us to partner with an organization such as Microsoft, and I'm very interested in exploring other opportunities we might have working with you along those lines. Note that those gray boxes at the bottom. We are able to work across a wide range of problems, including policy issues, procedural issues, technology issues, and educational and awareness issues, because we have partners at the university who've agreed to participate in collaborations from a variety of schools. This is our view of information assurance in the context of an organization. This is how we see the problem. We don't just focus on the mechanisms or the technologies. We're thinking about how it gets deployed in actuality, because in the end, unfortunately, it's the people that can circumvent even the best technologies. We have an active partnership with Pacific Northwest National Lab through a memo of understanding that's been signed between our two organizations. The National Lab in Richland has stood up a capability in information assurance, and Deborah Frinke is heading up that activity as chief scientist of the Cybersecurity Directorate. There's a list of people who work for her, but that's by no means exhaustive. This gives us incredible capability to direct at a problem. And this allows us, going back to that previous model, to look at research problems across a spectrum from high-level, pure research all the way to applied problems. Certainly, the Richland folks are very oriented towards applied research. These are the kinds of academic researchers and practitioners who have either worked with us in the past or who have agreed to work with us. Radha Puvendran is my go-to person for academic research collaboration. Whenever we have a problem and we're thinking about taking on, I sit down with Radha. He has the Network Security Lab at UW. He's doing amazing work in wireless security and in RFID. I'm the individual at the iSchool who has this on their agenda. And then in the computer science and engineering departments, some of these folks may be familiar to you. They've indicated an interest in being available on interesting projects. Hank and Steve Gribble have done interesting work quantifying, getting their arms around spam. Yoshi Kono is scary. I don't know if you've seen his latest his latest awareness effort, where he's waking up the public to the challenges of cybersecurity. He ended up showing that you can hack into a car. Did you see that? He just presented his paper at IEEE Security and Privacy, and I'm telling you, I was seeing the IRB all over us. He claims he got the guy who was driving the car to drive at a reasonable speed when they hacked into it and made it crash. But the guy had to sign off a waiver to say he wouldn't sue. I don't know. I mean, Yoshi pushes the envelope. When he first came to the university, he hacked into a pacemaker, and that really got all the people in the medical school on edge. So his whole point is we are embracing these technologies without thinking about the unintended consequences. And he's made some statements. Sam Chung from Tacoma is working with me on the secure coding project, integrating secure coding practices into entry-level programming courses. Neil Koblitz is a find. Neil is the co-inventor of elliptic curve cryptography. He's a rather unassuming, quiet person, marvelous lecturer, but certainly available for collaboration on projects. And Jane Wynn is somebody from the law school who's looking at trust issues along the supply chain. This is just a sample of the people who've raised their hands and said, you know, if you have an interesting problem, let's talk. Maybe there's something we can do. So we're talking about multidisciplinary research, really cross-domain, multidiscipline. On the practitioner research side, likewise, some of those names might be familiar with to you. Mike Simon is a go-to guy for me when we have directed research ideas that I want to vet. Kirk Bailey is the CISO at the University of Washington, who's doing some amazing things in inventing the CISO position. John Christensen is doing some things in IT law. He's the nation's expert on HIPAA, and he's taken on a new role with Rob McKenna now on a part-time basis, helping define what the Obamacare legal structure is going to look like when it gets implemented. Ilanko Subramanian is a gift from Microsoft. We've appreciated working with Ilanko from the Trustworthy Computing Department, and he's helped us craft a compliance model that we're applying to drug trial outsourcing to China. You may know Dave Dietrich, who's done some work with DDoS, who was involved in the very early stages of helping to create this center. And so on down the list, there's a number of people. Joe Simpson is here today, who's going to talk about his contributions in the systems engineering area. Now, these are the funded projects currently underway, the primary ones that we're focused on, as well as some white papers that we're circulating in terms of things that we are looking at getting into. The Next Generation Honeynet Project you're going to hear about in just a moment. It's looking at challenging conventional design that has grown up out of practice for these honeypot lures. And we're challenging some of the assumptions that have been made in these designs. I've mentioned the Secure Coding Project. This summer we're running a workshop for local teachers. We will be working with Microsoft. There's a number of people I've listed here who've offered to be advisors. Steve Lipner, Mike Howard, Arkady Retik, Ryan Hefferman, and I just had another person, David LeBlanc, indicate that he would join us. I'd like to have the opportunity to vet our materials. We are mapping our materials to all the good work that Microsoft has done. You're going to see a little bit in a minute how that looks. But we want to acknowledge that work and use it and integrate it into the classroom and do it from the get-go. What's not happening is those very beginning classes in programming where you could be offering some security concepts, but it's not happening. These are largely at the community college level. But we have an opportunity to change that paradigm here in the state of Washington. And I mentioned that we have an NSF grant that's allowing us to do that. And I mentioned the China compliance project that we wrapped up and delivered a model to the medical school. On the white papers, the things that we're looking at, we want to study the cyber warrior. That research agenda is just evolving, but it's very fascinating, and it needs to be examined. We also are looking at virtual world security, and if there's time, I'm going to play a little two-minute YouTube video that was just released to the White House yesterday, a novel way of looking at security awareness training. We are dealing with systems engineering to create, through systems engineering methods, to create an information assurance body of knowledge. We're dealing with IPsec interoperability and trust along the supply chain. So these are areas that we're exploring, that we're looking at expanding to add to our research agenda. Now, what I'd like to do is turn the meeting over to the two projects I mentioned that we would discuss to give you a sense of the kind of work that we're doing. This particular project, I call it the Information Assurance Body of Knowledge, using systems engineering to define the body of knowledge, the BOK. There are three people who are here who represent that team. Joe Simpson. To give you an idea of Joe's background, he has had long experience and interest focused in the area of complex systems, systems science, systems thinking, and systems management. Joe has professional experience in domain areas that include environmental restoration, information systems, systems security, aerospace, and defense. And his current activities and research interests are associated with complex systems modeling, evolutionary programming, the development of systems engineering language, and organizational assessment and improvement with a strong focus on adaptive security systems. He's accompanied by two other team members, Mary Simpson, who has broad interests. She likes music, languages, but has developed an expertise in dealing with system domains, systems engineering, dealing with system science and complexity. She was most recently with Battelle Memorial Institute. She worked as chief systems engineer with PNNL. And while she was there, she did a number of projects, including writing the Hanford Strategic Plan and Mission Direction document, and working with executive managers in places such as the Boeing Company. She's also served in multiple capacities for the International Council on Systems Engineering, called INCOSE, and she chaired the Corporate Advisory Board and was instrumental in expanding the membership. So she's a leader in the systems engineering movement. And also there is Dr. Vyacheslav M. Popovsky. If you folks wouldn't mind just standing up, there's Dr. Popovsky and Mary Simpson, and Joe's going to come up here in a minute. Dr. Popovsky is an affiliate professor in the Department of Education at the University of Idaho's Center for Ethics, and he has extensive research experience in pedagogy, particularly the application of the theory of pedagogical systems in higher education. He's a former associate professor in chief pedagogical practice with the St. Petersburg, that's in Russia, not Florida, Lesgas State Physical Culture Academy, and as a lecture, researcher, and coach and consultant for elite sports teams, he's published over 70 publications in his field throughout Russia, Europe, and the U.S. Now, the theme that's common in all of these three people is their interest in general systems theory, the behavior of systems at that archetype level in the abstract. And we're looking at how to incorporate principles from systems thinking, systems engineering, into informing us about the pedagogy of writing code. So, Joe, I'm going to turn this over to you.
Thank you, Dr. B. Is my mic on?
Can you hear me? Is everyone awake? Okay, yeah. There's some heads nodding. All right. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here today and to speak a little bit about a research interest in complex adaptive systems as they apply to information systems security. And I'm going to work through these slides a little faster than I planned so that I can give the other team a little more time. But so we'll just start by see if I can use this. Okay. So system security basically is an emergent property of a system. So system security basically is something that is not necessarily a characteristic in the system without a context. So if you take this system, you put it into a context, you're going to have an emergent property of whether or not it's secure. Value is determined is also determined in the system context. And most people would think that there's some kind of relationship between security and value especially if you're an organization and you're responsible for protecting the assets of that organization and using secure systems to protect those assets. And so one of the things that you're really going to ask yourself when you have that type of position, that type of job, you're going to say, well, how many resources should I actually assign to the security component? And how do I know that when I do these things within my systems development, I develop this kind of software, these type of operations, this type of training, this with my people, that in this particular context, I'm going to have a secure system. So that's one of the very interesting areas of research that we're working on. But we need a level, we need some ways to talk about this across large groups of people. So what we've done is we've developed this abstract model, and I'm going to talk about four levels of models when I go through this particular talk. I'm going to keep going back to the top and working back down again. But this one is called the Asset Protection Cube, or Asset Protection Model. What it does is it's kind of designed for cognitive reasoning ability of the average human being is able to understand these three things that basically would be components of asset protection. We have a threat, we have a system, and then we have a target. And then, okay, at the highest level, we look at this at some level of abstraction. Then we drill down one. Okay, we drill down one and we do it again. And say, okay, now we'll take a look at the system a little bit. And then we'll take a look at the threat a little bit, and then we'll take a look at the target a little bit. And we will, in a very structured way, go through and add more and more complexity to these areas, but always the target and focus in these cube areas make it so that people can reason about them. Within the system cube is set there so that communities like systems engineering communities can have a focus area for their interests. The target cube, in this case, the information assurance cube, is set there as a focus area for the information assurance community. And the threat cube is set there as a focus for the justice, the legal, and the IC community. So these folks that are normally their professions, we're allowing them to have points of focus, structure their areas, and then be able to drill on down to more and more levels of detail. So as I've said, the asset protection model basically is a structured framework for security topics, very high level, provides a focus for the affected professional groups, so these professional groups can start getting some common understanding. The key aspect of this is it's totally independent of technology, it's totally independent of organizational type, and so it's able to be stable. The information security cube itself, when you look at it, it's based on a system that's been out there about 20 plus years in the information assurance area. And you know in the last 20, 25 years, the technology, organizations, and threats, everything have changed. But this particular cube called the McCumber Cube is still valuable for information assurance people to talk about their area expertise. So the first thing we're doing is just trying to say, okay, we're going to have kind of a standard language. We're going to have a common language that will stand the test of time. It'll stand the change of technology. It'll stand the change of organizations. All right. Then after we do this, so now we have this kind of a language and some focus areas, and we have the organizations, we have these folks that actually have to go and decide whether or not they're protecting their assets correctly. And so we say, okay, how are we going to do that? Well, we're proposing a system security capability assessment model. Capability assessment model is different from a capability maturity model, has a different focus. This one is based on the systems engineering capability assessment model that was developed by the International Council on Systems Engineering basically in the middle 90s. And what it does is allows a group of people to look at an organization and decide whether or not they meet the criteria for protecting their assets well enough. And if they do, if you go through and you look at this, you do your assessment, you say, oh yes, we're doing well enough, everything's cool, we're not going to spend any more resources, then you kind of move on, but you also have a baseline. You've just now baselined all your security operations, okay? But let's say, as a matter of fact, that that doesn't happen and you need to do something. Well, then you need to evaluate the risk. So the system security capability assessment model really allows you to tie risk and value in context. And this does it in a very structured way. Now that we've kind of got this high-level A asset protection model, it's really generic, and we drill down to the organizational piece, now we're looking, oh, we're going to be able to tie risk and valuation in any specific context. Then we have a common view of security, organizational, and management processes. You notice the organizational support and management support processes were the same for any domain. We would abstract them, be the same type of management processes in a hospital for HIPAA as we would for the government. Essentially, you're going to do the same type of things. However, you're going to have different information control systems. So we need an adaptable security assessment structure for specific domain activities. But once you've gone through, you've looked at your model, you've analyzed your organization, and you decide, okay, now we're really going to do something when we think we need a system to improve our security, and we need some type of system to improve the way that we're protecting our assets. Then we would go ahead and we would start applying the system's perspective to start making decisions about the operational effectiveness and the operational suitability of anything that we would do there. Let's say, for example, a mission function. Let's say we have a city that's going to deploy a 911 type of emergency response. And so what they have to do is they have to be able to have communications. People call in. They just have to be able to find out where they are, log their calls, record them in some way, then dispatch people to help. So that's kind of the mission function. And so then we would design and deploy systems to support the mission function of the organization of the city. So we would get telephones, we would get radios, we'd basically get IT systems that had hosts and had back-end servers and so forth. And all the software code and all of the communication could be properly put together, and then those system functions would support directly the mission function. However, when we start looking at operational suitability, let's say that our system works perfectly. It supports our mission exactly the way we're supposed to. But someone took the SQL server that's in the back end, and they left the ports open to the internet. Okay? Well, is that operationally suitable, or are we letting threats in? Right? Or let's say I took the hardware that's supporting the system, and I put it out in an uncovered area, and I'm giving it electricity with a generator, basically, that gives a varying voltage. Well, is that operationally suitable? And in many cases, what we're looking at is our information assurance and our threat vectors are more in the operational suitability area than they are in our system function area. And this, we're very well prepared, mostly within systems and software engineering requirements development, to really know who to ask about functionality. And we're really well prepared to document our systems and software engineering techniques and to do our life cycles to produce certain functionality. We're not really as well prepared within our operational suitability area. Those are areas, I think, where we need some more focused research that helps us really balance that type of risk. Okay. So this is a secure adaptive response potential, which is a system security metric, which is based on an analytical hierarchical process, which is a type of technique for normalizing values across an organization. I don't know if anybody's familiar with it, but essentially what you can do with these four categories of this metric, which is organizational, technical, operational, and content, says these are the things we believe are important for information assurance and security and asset protection in any specific organization. So when we look at secure code, we say, okay, we're looking at what contribution to security would secure coding techniques make. We took at Lipner and Howard, and I just kind of highlighted the areas that are common. So these are basically areas that are probably for the system functions and the operational effectiveness are probably marked in green. And your suitability, your operational suitability, is probably the areas that are unmarked. And so we're looking at some techniques where we can actually go in and start saying, okay, what things can we really address by doing things better with code? What things can we really address by doing things better with deployment? And are there some kind of categories of certain types of systems that if we had a menu pick list that we matched to a deployment context, how would that work? Would that be valuable? Would that make things more secure? Okay. So the systems perspective basically provides a framework for a structured decision analysis when you're thinking about risk, you're thinking about operational effectiveness, and you're thinking about operational suitability, because you can decide to do very risky things. But I believe the most important aspect of an information assurance professional is that they have informed the decision maker exactly what those risks are. I think most decision makers, if they have cost-effective systems available to them, they're going to avoid any real risk to their assets by applying cost-effective barriers and cost-effective solutions if they're available. So it provides a balance between the architecture function and risk assessment. Yes?
What do you do about unintentional dependencies between low-value systems and high-value systems? Like somebody might use the same administrator password on both of them. One's well-protected, the other's not. Somebody gets the less well-protected, low-value asset, and it just happens to have a password that can be cracked, and then away we go.
Yeah.
So a lot of times it's difficult to identify the risk because there's these nearly invisible linkages that you may not be able to analyze easily.
Exactly. Okay. So there's architectures at different levels, all right? So someone did the password wrong, training. So basically, if I've designed an organization and I have these folks and I haven't done controls by separation of processes or separation of responsibilities, you know, you've allowed this type of password error to happen. First thing. Second thing is when you go in and you look at the architecture or the value of all your assets. In this particular case, did the organization value each piece of information? And said, this information is more valuable than that, and I'm going to protect this more than that. That's kind of what I'm getting from what you're saying. So those interfaces, right, the ability in that context, we now have at least two layers of value that we're talking about. And I don't believe that we do those well. And what I'm trying to say is we have a system function, which is administration, right, administrative password. We do these functions very, very well, but because of the value involved, the attacker will take more effort. They will do whatever they have to do to get to that. And we don't have the menu pick list of architectures or information protection categories within these systems that basically are self-reinforcing. And that's where the complexity comes in. And that's where I'm very interested in that type of research. But to even talk about that, which I'm struggling right now within the models in my own mind, you need to have a conceptual model topology where people can actually, and everybody understand it, all the people that are involved. Management, architecture, information, value folks. Those are, I believe, the issues and the solutions, those type of issues, and they have really little to do with software. Because every piece of software that employed the system could be perfect, right? So if we put more money into making more perfect software, that still is not going to help those things. So how do we draw the line, right? That's that answer your question? Okay. So the operational suitability and lifecycle cost considerations basically balance the decisions. And this is kind of an eye chart, but basically what it says is when we have our secure software education system down here, we are taking the components from our models that we've developed, we have a slot for those. Take the system architecture, put it over there. And as you can see, the threat, the different threat and the different values go in one for our exposure cube, right? The system specification that comes out of here, you're talking about how these things were hooked together. And then the system architecture when we're trading them off, which we're going to pay for, that's the other column. So these are the types of triplets of things that you really want to consider when you're thinking about how to analyze and deploy secure patterns. And so we'd actually start developing patterns, low-level application patterns at this area based on these higher-level models that we're establishing. This particular model really allows the communities involved to start addressing things that are important to them. And they now, once we put them into these types of formats, you can tell every computer scientist in the room that this is just a recursive type of pattern that goes down and basically comes out with a lattice. And so we have a ontology lattice that's developed here, which we can then put into a artificial intelligence type of activity. So there's a lot of software and things that would be behind this once these get fairly large. Because just at this level, there's just a little less than 20,000 interconnections between all these cubes. And so the relationships between these things are the things that we would then support the analysis of that once the humans that are focused in these areas have put in their information. So that's kind of the way that works. This is the pedagogy model, which Dr. B has talked about before, and exactly allows us to design a structured delivery of these concepts and patterns once these concepts and patterns have been developed. And of course, this is what I've just talked about now, a series of patterns that we would start developing that would fit in any case. And we can take those and refresh them as you go along from the professional organizations and the people that are affected, because this context is changing all the time. So we're going to have this type of delivery mechanism, which is prioritized once certain types of threats are taken care of and certain types of exposures are moved off, they don't see those anymore, they fall down in priority, then probably they won't be emphasized those as much, we'll get newer ones. So essentially, it's secure coding techniques are important, secure system deployment is important, cost-effective security is very important, because everybody's going to make the decision of my asset is worth X, if it costs me 2X to protect it, I'm not going to protect it. No one spends more money protecting an asset than the asset's worth. The software technology is only part of the solution, but it's a very important part. The operations process are only part of the solution, but a cost-effective, secure systems, I believe, are the solution, which we will be able to produce those and deliver those as a community of practitioners once we're able to precisely talk with each other about the structures necessary to do that. So, questions, comments, I think maybe the next presenter is?
Yeah, I think we'll go ahead. Okay. I do want to comment that this is a work in progress. So there's a lot of questions on the table, but you see what we're wrestling with, exactly what you were talking about, David. And what we could use as a model, if anyone was around when the Carnegie Mellon CMM model was being devised, the capability maturity model was being developed here 20-some years ago, that's what this is. And I think it's going to take a partnership of industry, academics, and government folks to really start thinking this through and developing the model so that it's robust and takes into account a lot of different scenarios. It's also capable, once we develop it, to be simplified. So cognitive simplicity is the ultimate goal, although right now it looks pretty complex. So next, I would like to introduce our Next Generation Honeypot Project, or Staying Ahead of the Bad Guys. Julia Narvaez is project lead. This is a project that we're doing with Pacific Northwest National Laboratory. Julia is a graduate student at UW and is graduating this June, which is really cool. So I'm glad we were able to get her here today. She's a systems engineer. She's a developer herself. She has her own company and has a degree in project management. She has extensive experience in the software development industry and lifecycle application. And her research interest has been this kind of thing in the last couple years. She's also going to be joined eventually by Ashish Malvaya, who's a first-year graduate student at the iSchool, who's currently working as a research associate at the center. He has 3 years of experience in IT infrastructure. He's my go-to guy whenever anything breaks. He's amazing. His past professional experience involves working with financial firms in managing and troubleshooting their data centers, and his research interest is information security. So I'm going to turn the podium over to Julia and to Ashish.
Okay. Thank you, Barbara. Good afternoon. So one of the areas of interest at the center is the study of cyber attacks, specifically client-side attacks. So this led to this project, which is assessment of virtualization as a sensor technique. This project has been conducted in collaboration with the Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, and participants include Ashish, Barbara, Doug Northwell from Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, Chirag Aval, who developed a honeypot that we call bare metal, Christian Seifert from Microsoft, He brings all the experience of the Honeynet Alliance, and he has been an advisor from the beginning of the process, and Barbara, of course. And we created the Pacific Northwest Honeynet Project last November, so we are active members of the project. Today we are going to talk about some background information, what the problem of study is, the objectives of our research, the approach and the conceptual methodology of our project, and the architecture, how we are going to conduct the analysis, future work, and there will be, I think, will be time for some questions. So how many of you are familiar with the concept of honeypots? Okay. So we know honeypots are security resources that whose value is the information they provide, and they are meant to be compromised. And they are deceptive by nature, and they frequently work in virtual environments. So there are so many types of honeypots, and the type of honeypot that is deployed depends on the type of attack that is going to be studied. In our case, we are interested in the client-side attacks, and we know malware development is exploding, and that growth is attributed to the professionalism of malware development. So there is a particular type of attack that is client-side attacks that is conducted to client applications such as a web browser. So the web browser sends a request to a malicious web server. The web server replies with a malicious page that launches an attack against the browser. If the attack is successful, the malicious web server pushes malicious code that installs into the client machine. In order to know how the malicious attack is conducted, we use honeypots. And this leads to a problem, because security researchers rely on virtualization on virtual technology to install honeypots to capture malware and to study the malware. But we know virtualization is detectable, and we also know that malware is becoming increasingly more sophisticated. So malware is able to detect if it's running in a virtual environment, and if it's And when that happens, it is capable of hiding its malicious intent, and we have seen it. And that has a problem for honeypots such as Capture HPC, which needs to run in virtual environment, and it can be detected. So this leads to our research questions. Given the sophistication of malware, how adequate are the current designs of honeypots? And how do malware and attacks behave in the presence of virtualization and when there is no virtualization? So in order to answer those questions, we have four objectives in our project. One is to develop a conceptual framework of deception in which we evaluate the honeypot design. A second is to propose a methodology for assessing design of honeypots. The third one is to test the honeypot design, and we propose a new architecture. And the fourth one is to compare the detection capabilities of honeypots running in different environments. So our objective one, we develop a deception framework for honeypot design. So I say that honeypots are deceptive by nature, and we adopt the conventional definition of deception, that is to make somebody think that something is good or true when it's actually bad or false. In the design of honeypots, there are three main challenges. One is the deception problem, the counter-deception problem, and the counter-counter-deception. So the deception problem is how to design honeypots that look like real systems. The counter-deception problem is what techniques are used to identify that a system is a honeypot. Because if a system doesn't look like a real, if a honeypot doesn't look like a real system, and the attacker is able to identify that it's not a system, it's a honeypot, the information that the honeypot is capturing might not be reliable, might be misinformation. And the third is counter-counter-deception, is how to design honeypots that make the attacker think that they are real systems. For time constraints, I am just going to focus on the counter-counter-deception problem. So Bell and Whaley, they proposed their theory of deception. They say that even though deception is done in an intuitive manner, we don't think how we do it, deception planning does follow a process, which is depicted in the deception planning loop. So we cheat for a purpose. And that purpose is supporting a deception goal, which is supporting a strategic goal. Once in order to conduct the deception, there are several characteristics that the deception planner is going to use. And the deception planner can decide what to show, what to hide, and how to conduct the deception. So it selects a ROS. The ROS creates an illusion, and if the illusion is accepted, the deception goal is accomplished. By accomplishing the deception goal, it fulfills the goal of the deception, and that supports the strategic goal. Relating to honeypots, there are many kinds of honeypots, and each type of honeypot can be deployed depending on the type of study, the attack that we want to study. But there is not enough taxonomy to classify the honeypots, and that delays the study of honeypots. So some researchers, including Christian Seifert, proposed a taxonomy of honeypots. They state the taxonomy of six areas of study, including interaction level, data capture, containment, distribution appearance, communication interface, and role in multi-tier architecture. These areas facilitate the study of honeypots. So we believe that the use of the systematic application of the deception theory combined with the taxonomy of honeypots helps the deception planner, which is the researcher, to identify the characteristics and the variables that are going to be considered every time that a research project is planned or the deception is being planned. So going back to our example, our deception goal here is to make the attacker think that the honeypot is an actual system and be attacked. According to the taxonomy of honeypots, we select the honeypots that we need. We say that, for example, the honeypots we use are high interaction client honeypots that don't avoid attacks. They just capture the information of the attacks. They capture information of any events or any attacks. The ROS is to give the illusion that a user is accessing a website or a client is sending a request to a server. And if that server accepts the illusion, think that it's really a user sending a request to the server, the server is going to launch an attack to the browser, and the honeypot is going to be able to capture the information of the attack, and that fulfills the deception goal. So applying this methodology, we actually are applying it, and that way we are able to control what variables we want to use during our research. So variables that we are controlling include the operating system, the type of honeypot, the version of the browser, and the environment in which the honeypots are deployed. The variables, we are deploying honeypots in two environments, one that uses virtualization and one that does not use virtualization. So this leads to the second objective of our research, in which we compare the detection capabilities of honeypots in two different environments, one that uses virtualization and one that does not use virtualization. which Ashish is going to explain.
Thank you, Julia. Julia already talked about the background behind the research in HoneyNet. I would like to just want to do a quick walkthrough, like what are our objectives behind the research. We want to compare the detection capabilities of a malware in two environments. One is virtual and another one is non-virtual, that is like physical machines. And after that comparative analysis, we want to do a statistical significance of discrepancies in both the environment. And we want to analyze the techniques used by those malware developers to detect the virtual machines and creating trouble to researchers. And with this research project, we want to inform and educate the community regarding the work that we are doing in HoneyNet research and to develop the requirements for next generation honeypots. So these are the specific objectives that we have covered this year. We have developed the bare metal honeypots in which we are running honeypots on actual machines and performing an analysis on malware behavior on those machines.
This is the first time
Anybody's
ever built a bare metal
honeypot. So Chirag Aval, alumni of Center of Information Assurance and Cybersecurity, has developed this honeypot, and we are successfully performing a research on this setup. And
did you have honeypots before there was virtualization?
Probably.
And we are in the process of performing these malware analysis of collected samples from these two environments. And in order to perform this experiment, we have developed an open source technique to restore clean image snapshots in minutes, because we want to make this work available for society freely. So we have developed a mechanism so that we can test these environment independently. So this is the architecture of a virtual environment where we have a machine running and the virtual environment loaded on it. The Capture HPC or HoneyNet client, HoneyPot client, is running on this virtual environment and accessing the malicious URLs, whereas the client HoneyPot server is controlling the operation of Capture HPC and monitoring the behavior of the client machine running on the virtual environment and collecting the logs from those malicious URLs. Similarly, we have another environment, which is the bare metal honeypot, a physical environment, where we have two separate machines. One is client honeypot server, and one is client honeypot client, which is accessing the malicious URLs. And the same way, client honeypot server is controlling the client honeypot client to access those URLs. And we are using the set of Windows PE environment and the USB containing the XP image to perform the boot sequence. When the client honeypot access the malicious URLs, it needs to be rebooted and formatted before it goes to access the second URL. So that operation has been done by Windows PE and Windows XP running on two separate USBs. The performance and the operation is almost similar, just the booting sequence, and it uses the wake on LAN signal and shutdown mechanism to control the client remotely. So third objective is basically it's about the experimental design. As we already discussed, that we assume that some malicious and malwares identify these virtual environments and they restrict themselves to download the malicious content. So we want to analyze the how they behave with virtualization and without virtualization. So our experimentation is to run these two environments parallelly and to feed them these malicious URLs at the same time. So we have a different data sources for malicious websites. We are getting malicious websites from Microsoft Malware Domain List and Shadow Server to run our experiment. So it's a quick snapshot of experiment. We have two environments running parallelly, and we are feeding our malicious URLs at the same time. So these are some preliminary results, which shows that there is a difference between the malicious URLs being accessed by these two environments. So we are in a process of diving in detail and performing the analysis why there are differences in detection capabilities of these two environments. So we will be performing the statistical analysis of the detection capabilities of honeypots, and we are taking into consideration all variables like environment we are using, the sources of URLs, and the time of running those URLs on both the honeypots. And then we are processing towards performing in-depth malware reverse engineering to capture the behavior of those malicious websites. Similarly, on the same lines, our future work involved developing a proof of concepts which proves that bare metal works and it captures the malware that detects virtual machines. So proof of concept is basically a shell code which will detect this virtual environment and restrict itself to download the malicious content. So our next step involves partnering with other research organizations for performing these malware analysis with us. So that concludes our research work in HoneyNet, and now I would like to hand over to Professor to summarize the presentation.
As you can see with the HoneyNet research, what we're attempting to do is turn this area of research into research and getting it out of the practitioner mode. The taxonomy of honeypots has had and has given us an ability to look at different types of honeypots, analyzing the effectiveness of each type, and maybe there is some additional follow-on work that will be done here this year. So to summarize, we have approached integration of domains, disciplines, and our topics in very innovative ways using systems engineering techniques, systems thinking. We've developed some key collaborations, diverse disciplines working together, working in emerging technologies, and looking at not just the technical side of things, but also the organizational impacts of security. Now, this is the final chart. I don't know if we have access to the internet here at the podium, but this is a link, and you can try it at your leisure, to Cybersecurity Island, which was just presented at the White House yesterday. We've developed a virtual world that's being used as a training theme park in cybersecurity to raise awareness of cybersecurity issues. It's a lot of fun, so I thought I'd leave that with you. It's a curtain raiser. This is a private URL. It is a YouTube video, but it's not made public, so if you want to try it, it's kind of fun.
You can't play it. It should be connected.
Should it be live?
Yeah. We just have to be out of here by 3.
Okay.
So. Is phishing there scams, identity theft, computer malware viruses.
Get the volume.
How can people be educated on the dangers of buried and persistent cybersecurity threats they face daily? Welcome to Cybersecurity Island Immersive. Imagine a traveler entering an immersive learning
experience
in 3D.
Is that
okay? The quest for cybersecurity is symbolized by the oily snake, representing false security measures, and the healing unicorn, representing secure systems built from the ground up. Cybersecurity Island is composed of several learning theme areas in addition to True Security Land. Through simulated experiences, the traveler is immersed in learning, and an awareness unfolds that the beautiful deep blue waters in the central fountain have healing powers. Watch as a virus-infected traveler drags herself to the healing waters to become well again. Enter the House of Illusion and Deception, for example, to learn about cybercrimes that involve both offensive and defensive illusion or deception. The traveler can learn some of the history of cybercrime through both deactivated and active examples of exploits. Learn about steganography, where information is hidden within objects, by traveling to Stego Country. A giant stegosaurus may grab you with its tongue. A Times Square scene lets the traveler explore various dishonest business practices. Without safeguards, your bits can escape or be stolen. Point out fraudulent activity on the island to a cop, and action will be taken. Signs and arrows lead the traveler to classrooms, such as an underground training session. Lessons learned on the island include security basics, password security, social network safety, phishing scams, financial fraud, identity theft, and malware viruses and worms. The traveler quickly senses the integration of the experimental, and academic lessons are humorously innovated with a respect for tradition. Cybersecurity Island is designed to form a lasting impression and stimulate the interest of a diverse group of learners. Come visit Cybersecurity Island and learn to be cyber safe.
Anyway, that gives you an idea of some of the projects we have going at the center. That was fun to work on. Are there any questions anybody has about what we're doing? I think we're ending right on time. Somebody's having cookies, so yeah, we don't want to stand between people and their snack there.
How do you see the future of this lab developing? I mean, what's your kind of longer term strategy?
You mean this particular?
Well, not with this, but just, I mean, with the lab as a whole.
We're on our way to
what's your vision for it?
What's the vision?
Yeah.
The vision's rather grandiose. I mean, we're on our way to establishing an institute in cybersecurity in this region. The capabilities and abilities of all of these various people and folks like yourself are astounding. And I've spent enough time with other centers, with people on the East Coast, whom I love. I'm from the East Coast. I don't want to cast asparagus. But I think that there is a groupthink that people out here in the Northwest are, in their DNA, designed to challenge. And I think it's going to take out-of-the-box thinking to solve the cybersecurity problems that we're facing. It's going to take interdisciplinary approaches. It's going to take cross-domain collaboration to solve our cybersecurity problems. I think there's tremendous promise in what we're doing with systems engineering. I see our being able to frame what we mean by cybersecurity and create a framework for conversations across domains. I've been invited to participate in an international committee this summer that is defining cybersecurity. They're interested in the contribution that we can make, the iSchool perspective and the systems engineering perspective. We've had tremendous cooperation from Microsoft, and what I was looking to do today was take that first step in introducing the kinds of things we're doing and hopefully expanding our relationship. I'm very excited. I mean, things are coming together. The systems engineering portion is the foundation. Making definitions of principles is the foundation of establishing a body of knowledge, and things grow from there. Integrating all of the things that you've done, I mean, there's places for all the contributions, the tremendous contributions you folks have made. You must feel like prophets crying in the wilderness with all the work that Lipner and Howard and LeBlanc have done, and nobody pays attention. Hello? Is anybody listening?
Well, until there's a problem.
Until there's a problem.
Yeah.
But what we want to do is incorporate all of that work and give it a platform for the kinds of audiences that we think we're starting to see accumulate around some of these problems. Does anybody on the team want to add anything?
Thank you for having us and hosting us.
You bet. Thank you.
Thank you.